A very warm welcome to our wonderful audience, the presenters and respected speakers. This is the second day of our conference, and I, Rita Thul, will be the moderator for the session of paper presentations. Yesterday was a very wonderful session with 7 paper presentations on the first theme of the conference, Cities, Issues and Challenges. And for this, we had presentations on the conservation of historic temple towns of Vrindavan and Mathura, on Gautams, on urban fringes and peri-urban areas. There was also research on the physical manifestation of a town in Bangalore, which was Basavanagudi, to be specific. And we also had a paper talking on the hill town of Dharamshala and its issues. Well, continuing with the first theme of the conference, we have 7 more presentations in this session today. We'll also be having a parallel session going over the papers from the first, second, and third theme of the conference, which is in the breakout room B. This is the breakout room A. Well, before we begin, I want to get a few points to your notice. Each presenter will be allotted 10 minutes for the presentation. And after that, 5 minutes of a question answer round session would be there, where the participants would like to ask some questions to the presenters. So I will request the audience to drop in their questions in the chat box during the presentations. And only the question answer session, round session, the questions will be asked to the presenter. Please note that. Before we start the session, I feel really honored in introducing our session chair, Architect Sangeet Sharma, sir. Although I am sure he needs no introduction, a well-known architect and partner in SD Sharma & Associates at Chandigarh, Architect Sangeet Sharma has many reputed projects to his credit. He has been conferred honorary doctorate by Berkeley University. His architecture is termed as Cubist Modernism and is highly influenced by Chandigarh, modern and sustainable architecture. He's widely published and featured in prestigious journals in India and abroad. He's a winner of 10 awards in architecture, significant being the Griha Exemplary Performance Award, 3 Projects Award for Sustainability, and various others for Best Structures to name a few. He has earned many momentous titles, such as one of the Hot 100 Architects, Famous 50, and Most Inspiring Architects of India in various books and journals. He has varied passions. He has authored almost 5 cult books on architecture, his latest being Castles in the Air. He's a sought-after motivational speaker and a great orator, and has delivered almost 150 talks, including many in universities abroad. He's a trained singer and a guitarist. He recorded a CD of his popular Hindi songs titled Melody with Me. He's an artist and was awarded the State Award by the World Wildlife Fund in Bangalore. He's also an educationist, profoundly taking interest in promotion of education. He founded A3 Foundation, a forum that promotes art, architecture, and aesthetics. The foundation organizes seminars, conferences, and awards for students, teachers, and associate professionals in the profession every year. A3 Awards are today a name to reckon with. Its versatility is noteworthy and is a delicate delight to define him. The profile is large as his personality and philosophy, which can shift areas of interest at any forum. Welcome, sir. It's such an honor and pleasure to have you today with us. With your permission, we would proceed towards the paper presentations.
Thank you very much. Thank you. Go ahead, please. Go ahead.
As I mentioned, we have 7 presentations in this session, all belonging to the first theme of the conference, Cities, Issues and Challenges. Today, we talk of the sustainable cities and also realize the importance of inclusive cities and urban spaces. The first paper of the session is all about inclusive sustainable cities and particularly discusses the case of women inclusivity in the national capital. I invite Dr. Aarti Grover, Assistant Professor at SPA Delhi, to present her research on Inclusive is Sustainable, Case of Women Inclusivity in the City of Delhi. Over to you, Dr. Aarti Grover.
Hello, everyone. Namaskar. And it feels really nice to connect in spite of the ongoing pandemic situation globally. I think the credit goes to the organizing team. who have made this possible. And also, big thank you to all participants for sparing time to discuss some really relevant concerns raised as the conference agenda. Today, I'm going to talk about inclusivity, and hence the title, Inclusive is Sustainable. I am detailing on the case of women inclusivity in my city, that's the city of Delhi, India. My presentation shall follow a framework wherein we understand the relevance of research and through literature and primary research establish the need of designing inclusive cities. The research shall through primary investigations infer whether public spaces in Delhi are considered as inclusive and hence preferred by either genders, specifically women. Since I have very short time duration given, so I'll rush, but I'll make sure that I cover all the important points. Let me start by exposing you to the sequence of gender space association in Indian subcontinent. This is very essential to know where we reach in the end of the presentation. You know, Indian womanhood has always been at the crossroads of changes, and hence the results have been evident in the space gender relationship at various times. From the beginning of Vedic era till medieval India, women were supposed to follow stringent societal rules which kept them bound into households. Largely, women were excluded from public domain. During the time of Mughals in India, women were secluded from common public spaces and they enjoyed women-only public spaces. Even today, in day-to-day life, women bogies in metros and trains and special ladies' buses are noticed. Also, today there is a visible clue of changing trends of gender roles due to education, emancipation, and gentrification. In the last 10 to 15 years, gender roles have actually come to a state of existentialism. Women have successively advanced into the spheres formerly dominated by men exclusively. As a result, they have started to project a much bolder and a much freer way of use and behavior in public spaces, especially in metros, metro cities like Delhi, which is the area of primary research in this case. But the big question remains whether these contemporary spaces are women inclusive in the true sense or they just claim to be. Let's see during this presentation. In India, referring to National Crime Bureau, it is evident that the crime against women in the public domain is increasing by the day. And the map here shows Delhi as one of the cities with highest crime rate against women. A survey about women's safety by ICRW in 2012 in Delhi revealed the similar grave situation, hence the validity of the case. So this study entails in-depth understanding of issues and aims to assess the status of women inclusivity at present in the city of Delhi. As mentioned earlier too, the research shall through primary investigations infer which public spaces in Delhi are considered to be inclusive and hence preferred by women. Coming to tools and techniques, case study method, literature survey method, and primary data method have been employed. In terms of primary data, we are looking at using covert observational technique and unstructured interviews. You know, the most appropriate example of women inclusive city planning has been the city of Vienna. So in 1999, officials in Vienna, Austria, undertook a detailed public survey to understand the needs of people and also see the relevance of the current city planning for the needs of people. The residents of the city were asked enormous number of questions through enormous number of questionnaires where they were asked about how they use public spaces, especially the transport facilities, the parks, and the residential complexes. So an apartment complex named Women Work City was designed for and by women in the city. What was done was that public infrastructure was remodeled and retrofitted to suit the women's ways of life. Another very relevant exercise was taken up wherein pedestrian mobility and better access to public transit was promised. If you see the picture On the left-hand side, you will see that additional lighting, sidewalks, and in this picture especially, a staircase with a ramp running through the middle was installed near a major intersection to make crossing easier for people with strollers and individuals using a walker or a wheelchair. Another critical area of research was how women use parks. You know, a survey was carried out which revealed that after the age of 9, generally girls did not use the parks. City planners wanted to see if they could reverse this trend by modifying the spatial character of parks. Again, certain retrofitting exercises were done, footpaths were added, boundary walls were looked at again with a new view, play courts were installed, and subdivision of larger spaces was done to smaller semi-enclosed spaces. And almost immediately, city officials noticed a change. Different groups of people, girls and boys, began to use the park, one group overrunning the other. Another important example, most of us may be knowing that Bryant Park was earlier a very dingy space with high levels of crime and unsafe situation for women. But in 1981, William Holy White was commissioned this project, and he's a famous urban sociologist who did a lot of surveys and time-lapse filming, and he did some renovation and retrofitting techniques to the park. And it was found that the number of women increased due to small interventions like using bistro chairs instead of fixed benches, and certain other changes as you see on the screen. So nowadays, most counts find the population of about 54% women daily, suggesting that the park provides a women-friendly environment. You know, these examples actually reiterate the fact that planning spaces sensitively could be an effective tool to better the lives of the users, and it is achievable. Coming quickly to the primary research, as I have spoken about the focus and area of primary research, I'll glide down quickly to understanding the criteria for selection of public spaces. You know, a thorough investigation of all types of spaces, including small streets, neighborhood parks, plazas with shopping at local level, open grounds, playgrounds, and large parks were made a part of the survey areas to ensure data from all corners. Other than these neighborhoods, some large parks were also included. All these areas were surveyed, and in case of residential streets, it was found that residential streets with local shopping received a much more number of women than the others. Streets with informal vegetable markets, bus stops, and park edges attracted women. Small neighborhood residential parks were also studied, and the criteria which mattered were context of the park, type of activity, presence of good infrastructure and amenities, level of security, and level of maintenance. In case of large parks, what mattered the most was the context and surrounding land use of the park. Of course, variety of spaces, level of security, and the variety of experiences that the park offered also mattered in the case of large parks. In case of plazas, it was found that enclosed plazas are less preferred, while the plazas which opened outwards generated a feeling of safety, and hence were considered much more preferred and inclusive by women. Other factors were scale of plazas, variety of shops that it had, and availability of infrastructure and environmental comfort. And in case of playgrounds and multipurpose grounds, sitting options and soft areas played the hero, and environmental comfort and type and level of activity also played a role in inviting more number of women. So the intended objectives laid out in the beginning of the study, including the comparative counts and the understanding of spatial preferences of both the genders in all public spaces, were revealed, understood, and analyzed. And it was found that in the urban public spaces of Delhi, although women were found using them for multiple activities, yet the number of women as compared to men has observed to be always less. Only in highly secured residential parks of small scale, women sometimes outnumbered men. and that related directly to the extent of inclusive character that these spaces displayed. Thank you.
Thank you so much, Dr. Aarti Grover. That was an interesting research. We have a few questions for you. Can I please ask you to please turn, can you please unmute yourself? There would be, Welcome to the session. Yeah.
Thank you.
We have a few questions for you in the chat box. I would like to take the first question. How do you see landscapes changing in post-pandemic era?
You mean post-pandemic landscapes?
Yes, yes. And probably especially related to your topic about women inclusivity, maybe that kind of area also.
I will start by saying that, you know, with the background of ecology and environment, it has been around 20 years that we all have been professing about sustainable landscapes. We have been talking about sustainable means of living. And, you know, it's not far in the history of mankind that we used to live in real, you know, symbiotic relationship with nature. You know, as we started to grow as a community, which is now sort of developed, I mean, it's a rhetoric that we started to develop like a community which is more developed, but then our relationship with the nature, with Mother Nature, has kind of deteriorated. We started to utilize it and then started to exploit it really, really soon. Now, coming to your question, which is principally asks me, how do I see the landscapes in post-pandemic situation? You know, it's actually a very hard hitting question as to whether this association of ours with the Mother Nature is the best way of handling it, or do we need to look at new dimensions of how we connect landscape and human life. You know, ideally, it has been last 20 years that we are seeing the meaning of landscape has changed. We need to reimagine. Now, if in the given situations, like in COVID-19, for example, it is here to stay. You know, we can't actually close our eyes to the fact that COVID-19 is a big event in our lives, and the way it has changed how we have started to live, work from home, situations like that have really changed. In terms of landscape also, we see that marketplaces have gone devoid of people.
Absolutely.
And we are seeing that, the public spaces especially, we are seeing them really with no public at this point of time. Right. Having said that, we can't forget the role that the public landscapes or the greens have for us. For example, the regional greens and the city level greens, if you see that, if you consider that at a city level, you will realize that they will continue, and they are continuing to bestow their ecosystem services and their own benefits more to do with ecology in this time also. We can't negate that fact. Yeah. But, you know, another important thing with landscape might turn out to be now is probably that we might look at flexible use of landscapes. For example, you must have heard of this situation where Central Park in America has been used for medical facility in this crisis. And same has happened in India also. So what I'm trying to hint at is that these open spaces are going to be there, are going to serve us. Maybe the meaning might change a little in the given situation. And also, you know, I like to bring to your notice one important fact that in this kind of situation, what we have been, as you know, I'm a professor of landscape architecture, what we have been professing for ages now that we have to look at the models of Singapore. We have to, we might not like certain countries for their political agendas, but look at China for doing certain things in terms of landscape and in terms of urban planning. They are going ahead of us, right? And if you see these concepts of eco-cities, sustainable cities, green cities, biophilic cities, they are the newer concepts. We need to look at those. This is at the city level. But if you talk about, so in city level and also in the public spaces, this landscape has to become
newer that meaning.
Canvas on which the social life should proliferate. In terms of community life, if you say, I will say parochial realm is something which we need to dwell into now. You know, we have only been knowing public and private. Now, this parochial term has been coined in 1980s. Have we ever looked at that as a part of research? Not really.
Absolutely.
But that's the time that we look at that also.
Yeah.
And then so, in terms of detailing, if you see vertical gardens, and there are a lot of things I can go on, but of course, I'm sure we are short on time.
Just one more question, because also I feel that I think this pandemic has revived the nature back and has created a platform for us to start again, you know, since we all are locked down inside and the nature's playing its role. So I think probably it's reversing, so it's like a good platform to start with and reviving the ecology.
You must have seen, all of us have seen that during the last 3 months, nature has actually displayed her presence
absolutely
in a magnificent way. You know,
we need to respect that.
On internet, green ecology all around,
absolutely, the bird life, the flora, fauna,
and AQI indices, which absolutely are like coming back to normal. They are
absolutely
going as you will have in New Zealand. I mean,
absolutely,
did you ever expect them, especially in
true
the city where I live? Our AQI had risen
absolutely
to 1100.
Absolutely.
Now you were back to 60. I mean,
true,
unimaginable.
Yeah. So I think it's a good platform to start with. As a human, we should respect the fact that
there is no other way.
Yeah, true. Just one more question, ma'am, I'll just take. With respect to built forms and open spaces, how do you measure the quality of a space and security?
Quality of a space, how do you measure it?
Yes. How do you measure it? The quality of a space and security. What would be the measurables? You know, how are the few measurables, which, like, if you can just brief it up. Right?
Definitely. Yeah. So, you know, we are talking about the quality of life and we are also talking about safety. Mm-hmm. I have an objection on that. You know why? Because the person who has written this question, my assumption to him is that let's see how finely our brains are tuned to quality of life, and the parameter only which is coming to my mind is safety. Safety is one parameter of quality of life. It's just,
but I think it has to be both, right?
No, there are so many. Except,
but it's an essential. Safety is the priority, you know.
Also, you know, my submission is that when we look at quality of life, let's look at it as an umbrella term. It's a very holistic term. How do you and I as women want to live in our city? Is
absolutely
it only safety? No, we are also consumers
freedom
of the space.
Absolutely.
We also want to
equality
the space. More than safety, we should also look at the experiential quality of the landscapes that we are,
absolutely,
the aesthetic quality, the functional
absolutely
quality, the
absolutely
ecosystem services that we are getting, as men are getting. I mean, in the morning, I was hearing the session by the lady from Bangladesh, and she was talking about gender equity. And yes, of course, safety is one very important part, because unless places are safe, you know, there is a very intelligent research piece by, actually, he's a very good researcher, Cheryl Menard. He's a very great researcher in this field. He talks about street harassment for women. And he talks about how you must have known about these three waves of feminism that we all have experienced in our lives. Our grandmothers have experienced the wave one, our mothers have experienced the wave two, and we are in the wave three, so to say. But, you know, as these waves of feminism have reached India, we also have seen women started, you know, their journey has also flourished in a different way. There was a time when we did not have access to public spaces at all.
True, ma'am. Yeah.
You know, Panini talks about, this Indian scriptures, they talk about Asurya Pasham Darha, which means women, the wives of the king who do not see the sun.
Yeah.
And if you and I today had to live without sun, would we ever accept that?
Yeah.
Things are changing. Safety
absolutely
is one part of it.
I think,
Yeah,
thank you, ma'am. Thank you so much. I think since we are running out of time and we have a lot of participants more, I would not be able to take a few more questions. But thank you so much for those insightful thoughts.
Before ending, I have to compliment you. You are doing a great job. And
thank you so much,
Aradhana ji. Thank you so much, Shiva ji and Pratik ji, for getting me on here. Thank you so much.
Thank you so much, ma'am. Thank you. All right. Thank you so much, Dr. Aarti Grover. Very beautiful and insightful thoughts. Since we're running out of time, I'd like to take the next one. So walking through the narrow and wide streets of a city is a thing so common, but the new dimension to understanding of these narrow streets with high-rise structures on the edges is that these impact our emotional, mental, and physical health overall. We have with us architect Pratik Dasmana from Chitkara School of Planning and Architecture, Chitkara University, Punjab, to present his research on impact of urban ravines on mental health and walkability. I invite him over to Architect Pratik Dasmana. Could you please start your presentation?
A very good afternoon to all the participants, the organizers, and the jury members. So my topic for today is impact of urban revise on mental health and mobility. So in this topic, I'll be discussing about what are urban revise, how they are formed, and what are their effects on mental health and mobility. So basically, urban revise are basically, if you see in the left side, the image that is in the left side, this is an urban area of Delhi. So in this area, you are seeing that basically there are houses built that are very close to each other. The street width is not that much, and the height of the building is like very much higher. So if you can see the solar envelope, the sky exposure that is seen from the ground floor is very much less. It is a very narrow passage of sky exposure that can be seen. And on the right side, this is a location known as Robber's Cave. Basically, Robber's Cave is an urban ravine, you can call. This is a landmark that is formed naturally. So basically, these are caves, but this has an opening on the top. So if you can see the sky exposure of this particular place, it is also somewhat similar to the urban area. And the passage on the horizontal plane, that is on the ground, is also very narrow. So if you can relate both the images, there is some type of relation, but the left side of the image is in the built environment that is built by the human beings, and the right one is the natural one. And this is how I am comparing a natural ravine to an urban ravine, that places like these become an urban ravine. The characteristics are same. If you are walking in the street on the midnight without any light, and if you are walking in the cave without any light at the night, so you will feel the same effect. Like walkability will be affected because there will be no sense of security, and it will be a very it will affect the mind, because we are not able to walk on those places which are not at all safe and which are blocking your mind all the time. So basically, I have taken two characteristics that can be very feasible to define the urban ravine. The first one is sky exposure and solar envelope. Now basically, sky exposure is very much necessary. If you don't have enough sky exposure, the building height is too much and the width of the street is too low, so we are getting a bad solar envelope. So basically, solar envelope is very much necessary. And the second point is enclosure and walkability. Now, enclosure and walkability, I have related both the things, because if there is a very narrow enclosure and the height of the buildings are very high, then the walkability will obviously get affected, because everyone likes to walk in a place which has a good road width, and the height is also restricted at some point. But if it is a narrow tunnel type, then someone will hesitate to move in those particular streets, because of and especially during the night time, when the street lights are also not working. So basically, it has some type of claustrophobic feeling when you are walking. So now, to be very precise, this study is basically, the purpose is basically that how these urban ravines are affecting the mental health and walkability of a user. So basically, for mental health, I gave survey forms in the locality of New Delhi, which is Butla House, Masigad, and Sarai Zuleja. These three are localities which have a minor difference in the street width. So I just made a health questionnaire and distributed among the masses there, so as to get the perception about that particular place, and if they are feeling any mental depression, or if they don't find it very much the streets user friendly to walk, and their experience of walking in that particular area. So basically, as I have already told, my aim was to establish that urban ravines leads to mental discomfort and decreased walkability. And objectives were the relationship, to establish relationship between natural and man-made ravines, to study the types of urban ravines and sky exposure angle, to study the relationship between walkability and urban exposure, defining a good sky exposure to walkability and comparing it to exposure present in urban ravines, then to study the psychological impact of sky exposure in urban enclosures, and finding solutions to the problem prevailing in the study areas. So methodology, I already told you, 32 questions were formed. Literature review was done from the research papers prevailing in Italy. Like in Italy, you also get these narrow streets. But you know, the architectural features of these streets are so much high that it automatically generates the interest of the user to walk in those streets. But in these streets, you know, the activities like very haphazard activities are going inside, very traffic. During the daytime, it's very congested and situations like these. So questions were formulated in such a manner that, you know, people can express that how they are feeling living in that particular area or walking in that particular area. So as you can see in the map, three locations have been marked, and the analysis have been carried out with the same questionnaires, the same sets of questions and same set of technique were used in all the three streets. Now in the results and discussion, if you can see, urban ravine one is Masigad. It has a street width of more than 3 meters, and as you can see, the sky exposure angle is 106 degrees. So here, if you, I have taken out the correlations of all the streets in like some parameters. I have correlated that correlation between less comfort level of street proportion and claustrophobic feeling. So in in both the three streets, like if you talk about the urban ravine two, Sarai Judena, like equal to 2 meter street width, then your Butler House is 1.5 meter street width. So as you can see, the correlation graph, the line is continuously going up. It is a strong correlation that less comfort level and claustrophobic feeling, it is, you know, directly proportional to each other. It's like, this is just a one factor. I have framed at least 10 to 12 factors to prove the facts. So I can tell, like, this is the, these three are the images of Butler House, Sarai Judena, and Masigad. So now, as you can see, the activities going around there, like no prominent architectural features are there. So as to increase the walkability, there is haphazard things going around, and there is complete darkness on the ground floor. You don't receive any sunlight. So basically, it is affecting the mental health as well, because sunlight is very much necessary. You get, it is a good source of vitamin D. So this thing is missing in these urban ravines. And here, the if you compare the problems people are having, health problems, so they are having high blood pressure and cardiac arrest problems are there, and like low visibility problem is there, oxygen levels in the body have been less in this particular case. So these are the results, if you can see. So like as you can see, the psychological issues I have taken, like fear of fire and earthquake, irritated due to narrow streets, irritated due to monotonous streets, irritated due to congestion, inconvenient due to traffic noise, socially disappointed, isolation and loneliness, degree of uncomfortableness, claustrophobic feeling, and degree of poor aesthetic feeling. So if you can see, like the streets which are like the Butler House street, this is a prominent feature. So, but one thing is to be pointed that, so people are less socially disappointed in this particular area. That's why they are opted to live in this particular area, because you know they are habitual to living in these areas. Their social fabric is very much strong in these areas, so they don't want to move out. Other than that, if they are feeling all these factors living in this area, this is proved by the questionnaire I have formed. The conclusion is basically like how can we tackle these all these problems. So after all these analysis, all these things thing had came that, you know, you can take certain urban design, you can just regulate some urban design norms for this particular area regarding the facade of the buildings, regarding the street width of the building, and restricting the height of these buildings as well, because you know this will increase somewhat, this will increase the walkability as well, and also affect the also less effect the mental health of the people. Plus more of the sunlight is very much necessary to the projections here. So there can be facade regulations in the particular area, height restrictions and other restrictions, keeping the mental health and the walkability of these people in mind. So this was all about my presentation. Thank you very much for your patience and presentation for listening to this presentation. Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you, Architect Pratik. Thank you so much. Well, we move to our next presentation. The streets are not alone the mode of connectivity and travel, but the safety, belongingness, and ease of access becomes a concern and priority with urbanization. The next paper is by Varsha Khetrapal Kumar, Dr. Jay Prakash Chanchan, Dr. Sudipta K. Mishra, and the title is An Approach Towards Street Selection to Evaluate Its Completeness, Case Study of Gurugram. And we have Varsha Khetrapal Kumar, who's a research scholar of School of Architecture and Planning, G.D. Goenka University. I please invite Varsha Khetrapal to please give her presentation. Over to you, Architect Varsha.
I'm Varsha, and today I'm going to present my paper on An Approach Towards Street Selection to Evaluate Its Completeness, Case Study of Gurugram. Firstly, I would like to brief you about what this presentation is all about. Here we will talk about the urbanization and its effect all across the globe. Secondly, because Gurgaon is one of the major contributors to the urbanization in India. So I have selected Gurgaon as my case study area. And secondly, because Gurgaon is also rated as most polluted city in the world, and Gurgaon is also facing poorer transportation network. Gurgaon has a vehicle-centric approach. Gurgaon is facing a lot of guru jams because of poor infrastructure. So all these things have together brought this, that we should study about Gurgaon, because Gurgaon needs a street improvement big time. This presentation will talk about the background. Now, to have a better streets, we should have complete streets, which is recently, like 10 years back, people have evolved these policies, and many American and European cities are already following these complete streets, because complete streets are safe and accessible streets, and streets are the major part of any city to be developed. So in this presentation, we will talk about what complete streets are. And the major aim of this paper is, if we want to achieve complete streets in Gurgaon, then which streets should be selected to have to evaluate the completeness of that particular street. So I will start with the presentation that nowadays rapid urbanization is creating a lot of alarming situation across the globe, and we are facing a lot of infrastructure related issues. We are facing a lot of environmental issues across various cities. So it is important that urbanization should be handled properly. To support the urbanization, streets are one of the major things. They support as a backbone of the city. So to have a better street and good connectivity, to have a better cities, we should have a good connectivity and better streets. Since last 5 decades, people have been designing roads for vehicles. We are doing street widening to accommodate more and more vehicles, and we are forgetting our pedestrians and other non-motorized transport users. So it is high time for us to now to look for the NMT users and not to the vehicles. We should have people-centric approach in our design, not the vehicle-centric approach. The concept of complete street is being practiced towards making streets safe and accessible. Complete streets are well-planned and well-designed and well-connected streets. Many Asian countries are facing FASD, which I have already discussed about. Gurgaon has the highest per capita income in the country, and almost 68% of the urban population is staying here. It is showing tremendous growth in population, which is expected to be 42 lakhs in 2021. And this population growth needs to be handled properly, and that's why the burden is coming on streets as well. So when we talk about complete streets are context-sensitive streets. Complete streets are safe and accessible streets, and it can be accessed by all types of users. It gives opportunities to the street users to choose their mode of preferred mode of transportation. Complete streets has a lot of benefits, that it gives easy access to the traveler. Any mode of transportation can be used. Mobility choices are increased. It helps to achieve the health goals as well, because people can use anything than bicycle and walking and all. Then it gives economic and social benefits to the communities as well. So these are the certain benefits of having complete streets. Now the point is how to achieve complete street. The complete streets, based on the literature review, the complete streets can be achieved through four subheads. First thing is street context. That is, we should know what kind of existing and future land use context on that particular street, and what kind of transportation context is there on that street, such as it is having residential land use along it or commercial land use. Because as per the land use, the road users and the usage of the road changes. So it is important to understand the existing and the future land use. Like if something is, some area is not developed, then we should know that what is coming up next. Second thing comes as quality of services, where we talk about majorly the facilities for the street users. Third thing is the street design elements, such as street lights, street furnitures, then footpaths, the segregation in the footpath, type of median, the quality of median. So all these are the street design elements, whether they are there or not, and if they are there, what condition are they into. Fourth thing is the urban design quality for the pedestrians. Urban design for the pedestrian is important, because pedestrians are the people who are actually spending the most of the time on the street. The car users are not doing that. People are standing, people are walking, people are waiting. So pedestrians should be considered while designing, and they should feel safe. They should have good image of the place. They should feel, they should have the feeling of enclosure. So all such things needs to be kept in mind when we are designing the urban design or the land uses along the street. American and European countries have already started working towards a complete street. In India also, Delhi, Bangalore, Pune and Ahmedabad have started working. But it is majorly right now retrofitting or just the correction of this cross-section of the road. It is not connecting to the land use across, along the road, which is also very, very important. Coming to Gurgaon, Gurgaon is actually very strategically located, because it is only 30 kilometers from Delhi and 20 kilometers from International Airport. National Highway is passing through the city, so it is giving a lot of importance to the city. Now, coming to the development of the Gurgaon, Gurgaon has developed in various phases. And if we see the phases, the old Gurgaon has narrower streets, which is 6 meter, 9 meter, 12 meter, and maximum 24 meter. Whereas the new Gurgaon has the minimum road width of 12 meter and going up to 75 meter. Gurgaon is divided into five zones: Old, North, Old Gurgaon, North Gurgaon, South Gurgaon, Golf Course Zone, and the Upcoming Zone. In these zones, the Old Gurgaon, North, South, and Golf Course Zone are already developed. They are 90% developed, whereas the upcoming areas have 30% development. Gurgaon has a very high vehicle ownership rate. Almost 33% of the people own cars, whereas as compared to Delhi, it's only 20%. But in a survey, it is found that 85% of the people responded that they would like to walk at least up to 800 meters. So it is actually sad that people want to walk, but they don't have place to walk, they don't have facilities to walk, they don't feel safe while walking. So all these things can be overcome if we have complete street. if we have complete streets, so then people can walk, and it will also help in reducing the pollution and the congestion on the streets. Hence, now we know that we actually need the complete street. Now my next point is, since we need the complete street, now where to start from? So this is the main question, that which street should be selected, that should be taken first to be evaluated as complete street, so that it should help the major part of the population. So now the street selection, a street can be selected majorly on the basis of two things. One is the street function, and second is the street context. Street function is like we are working on accessibility. So accessibility is more on collector and local streets, and arterial roads and sub-arterial roads are more on the mobility. So they have more vehicle-centric approach instead of people-centric approach. So the function is collector or the local street that we are taking. Similarly, street context is the land use along the street. So now coming on to the detail, the street function, first thing I have already explained, the accessibility. Second point of selecting collector and the local street is, as you see the table down, the collector and the local streets are the streets which contributes to 53% of the total road length. So that is the maximum of it. So if you are doing some study for a maximum of the chunk, then it is automatically applicable to the lower categories as well, or the lesser numbers as well. So because you get more challenges, more varieties, it is like that. So same thing is also mentioned in the master plan. Out of total 16 road hierarchies are identified in the master plan, out of which 4 of them are collector streets up to 24 meter, and below 24 meter roads are mentioned in the sector plan. So these are the 7 types of roads with 60, 30, 24, 18 and 15 meter road right of way, which is serving as a collector road. And some of them are mentioned in the master plan, and some of them I have picked from the sector plan. Now coming to the land use of along the street. In an urban area, there are majorly 4 types of land uses which we find. That is residential, commercial, open and institutional. And as per master plan, these land uses contribute to almost 85% of the land allocation. So I think 85% is a good amount. So these 4 land uses can be seen on the road in 10 combinations. We might have different land uses on either of the side. So we should have different cross sections. So this basically means that we cannot have one fit to all solution. We should have a case specific solution as per the land use or as per the requirement. As we have identified the 7 streets, now what is happening? We are overlaying these streets to the land use. So if you'll see the width of the street, the function of the street is here, and the land use along the street. It's 60 meter wide road, which is majorly as a arterial road, not as a collector. So 3 places we found that it is serving as a collector road, where we have found these things because it's in the New Gurgaon. Rest of the streets are all collector roads. The 30 meter wide road is the road which is having all kind of permutation and combinations, and all locations are there. Rest of the roads, if you see, like 60 meter doesn't have commercial, institutional and open as collector and road on there, because commercial are there, but it is an arterial road, it is not collector road. So similarly, there are other roads also which doesn't have certain things, which is a logical also, because the wider roads have more commercial and institutional functions, and the lesser roads have more of the residential functions. So it is evident from this that 30 meter wide roads are the only roads which has all kind of street land use types along it. So when we overlay these two things, if you see the map above, the yellow line or the yellow circle is almost 90% developed area of the Gurgaon, which is part of North, South and Golf Course Zone. And it also has all the types of land uses. So this is evident. So that's why 30 meter wide road is the one criteria for selection. Now coming to 13, and if you see the plan, and the, all the 10 locations were marked, which is shown on the table also. So all these 10 locations have various types of land uses across them. And these were the areas selected. Now coming to the conclusion, it is evident from the study that every street has some strength, weakness, and opportunities and threats, which is associated with the existing streets and its planning. So that will be identified, that what potentials they have. Second thing is, the 30 meter wide streets are the only streets which has maximum variety of the land use. So we are getting all kind of land uses on 30 meter wide road only. So we can conclude that 30 meter wide roads or 30 meter wide road here, because we are getting all the varieties of land uses to study. So we are going for that. Second, these streets are present in 90% developed area. So we get to see the challenges and the problems in the existing areas, which is already functional. So that's another reason for selecting these, because new areas has all the 60 and 75 meter wide roads, and the older area has much, much narrower streets. The selected typology of the street has maximum road length among all. So maximum road length covered means maximum place is evaluated. So that's another thing. Other types of streets has lesser variations and can be studied after studying the larger category and variety. Further to the selected streets, after selecting it, we can evaluate it on the basis of identified parameters based on the literature review to evaluate the completeness of the street. So once the street is selected, the next step is to identify the parameters to achieve the complete street, and then the survey can be done for the same, and as a result, the completeness of the street can be evaluated. Based on the completeness, we can prioritize what work to be done and which work to be done to achieve the complete street, and that can be focused accordingly. Thank you very much, everyone, for listening. Thanks a lot.
Thank you, Architect Varsha Khetpal. I welcome you. Can you please switch on your camera? A few questions for you.
It is not allowing me to start my camera. You can't start it because host has stopped it.
We have started it.
We can see you. I can see you and hear you as well. Yeah. A few questions for you. Can you hear me? Are you?
Yes.
As you're talking about completeness of street and you're talking mainly of city, there's a question: can we achieve completeness of street at the urban-rural fringes of Gurugram?
See, urban-rural fringes does not have the similar kind of a situation what we have in the urban areas, because urban-rural fringes are those areas where people are actually commuting for their daily life to the city, majorly for the work or for the education. So their major traffic is morning and evening. Whereas urban streets are those streets where people are moving throughout the day and they are actually spending time on the street. So you can achieve complete streets, but then the parameters will be different.
Right.
Because when we talk about safety and accessibility, then if like fourth thing that I have said, that urban design element. So urban design element is one of the urban area criteria, that is one thing. And second, it is further linked to further five more things like enclosure, connectivity, then what physical elements you have. So things like that. So urban fringes can be achieved, but then parameters will be different.
Of course. Okay. Okay. One more for you. Criteria for complete streets obviously vary from city to city. So are there any particularly very generic thumb rules developed for street context and services particularly?
Majorly two things. Like I said, function of the street and land use along the street. So in any city in India, if we want that complete street to be done, then there are certain parameters which has been identified based on the best practices and the literature review and based on the usage as well. So those parameters can be taken to another city also.
And if the land use context is same, like I'm talking about four land use contexts, which is the major land use context in the urban area. So if those land use context is same and the other situations like the users are similar kind of, then I think everything, it can be replicated to the other cities as well.
But my question is only the land use and the function are the two major factors, or it's also about the population and the age? I think there are many sub factors also, I'm sure, to it.
Population is not affecting much
the
because every road
and everything. Is it because you were talking about the completeness of streets? So would be the age group according, you know, the, there would be a different use also for the street section to happen. So
yes. When we talk about accessibility, when we go further down and bifurcate the accessibility, it actually takes care of the age and the physical health of the person who's using. So physically challenged, women, kids, all right. Those things comes under accessibility. Right. And function, yes, function is actually generating the population. So that's why I said, because commercial area is having different kind of population,
right.
And residential area has a different kind of population. So these are the two broad things which I think takes care of everything.
All right. Okay. Thank you so much. Thanks a lot.
Thanks a lot.
Thank you. Thank you. I appreciate your efforts and your research. Thank you.
Thanks a lot. And thank you so much for giving this forum to us to present our work.
I think it's very insightful thoughts for all of us. Thank you.
Yes. Thanks a lot. Thank you. Bye.
Bye-bye. Thank you so much. Well, past decade has witnessed a huge growth in the trend of gated communities in developed cities, particularly like Chandigarh and its satellite towns, Mohali and Panchkula. Next paper discusses the common spaces within these gated communities. So here I invite architect Preeti G. Bhatia to present the paper by herself and architect Masara Bhatia. And the title of their paper is The Morphology of Common Spaces in Gated Communities in India, Case AWHO complexes in Chandigarh, Mohali, and Panchkula. I invite you, ma'am, to start your presentation. Over to you, Architect Preeti, ma'am.
Hello, namaste, adab, and warm greetings to all the organizers, hosts, speakers, and listeners from all across the world. I'm Architect Preeti Gupta Bhatia. I have a fair share of experience in the field of practice, pedagogy, and research. My co-author for the paper is a young architect and lighting designer, Masara Bhatia. The subject of this presentation today is the morphology of common spaces in gated communities in India. Now, as we are all aware, that in response to the swelling world population and its rapid urbanization, which is projected to be 68% in 2050, new infrastructure challenges have cropped up in the last 20 years. The most urgent challenge, perhaps, is housing, in response to which new typologies have emerged. Gated communities, well, they certainly are the new kid on the block, fast gaining popularity by pandering to the demands of bullish market, changing design trends, planning legislations, and other interest groups. All across the urban landscape around the world, one comes across large hoardings promoting the sale of gated communities or housing societies, as they are commonly called in India. Do you remember what you actually saw the last time you were driving past such an advertisement? Perhaps it was something like this. A place different from the city, where you can have close contact with nature, lush greenery, a secluded and tranquil world away from the urban bustle, yet providing access to all social amenities. The quality of life shown here is seen to be impacted and identified not just by the quality of private spaces, but of the common spaces as well. And it is this implied relation between the quality of life and common spaces that turned my attention towards these for my MR thesis. deeper study also revealed that while much research has been carried out in the foreign countries, not much has been done in the Indian countries. It was also realized that most of the research focused on the social aspects, validity, types, impact, and origin of the gated communities, and not much on the design aspects, which could actually help in setting some design guidelines to enhance the positive effects and minimize the negative effects of these communities. So the aim of the study was established, which was to study the physical characteristics and perceived efficiency of the common spaces in gated communities and arrive at a morphology of the same. Accordingly, some objectives were also framed. The research for this was carried out in two phases. First, the literature review to explore and understand the nature, evolution, and issues related to this housing typology, for which a systematic online study of journals, papers, books, planning guidelines laid out by UN Habitat and CPTED, which is the crime prevention through environmental design, were studied and presented in the thesis. The second phase of the research was empirical and involved case studies. For this, a triangulated approach towards the data collection and data analysis was adopted through 1, study of statistical data, 2, carrying out a survey, 3, visual analysis. The case studies chosen were 3 gated communities in the Tri-City: Rajiv Vihar in Chandigarh, Darshan Vihar, Mohali, and Sandeep Vihar in Panchkula. So the study of statistical data included study of site plans and their areas, and this led to the documentary analysis consisting of analysis of area, analysis of zoning, and analysis of circulation. The survey analysis was done after preparing a questionnaire to study the perceived satisfaction level of the users with the various activities and planning aspects of the common areas. 90 persons participated, 30 from each community. And visual analysis comprised of my own observations as an architect. This was presented in a sequential manner, starting at the end of the public realm, that is at the gated entrance of the society, and ending at the beginning of the private realm, that is at the entrance of the dwelling unit. All this was observed, documented, and supported with photographs. And all the above was then compiled on spreadsheets, analyzed, and synthesized to establish a correlation between the perceived satisfaction level of the residents and physical features of the common areas. Some major points that emerged at the end of this exercise. 1, these spaces may not be known as public spaces due to ownership issues, but they definitely are to a gated community where public spaces are to the city. And they're actually not just the skeleton of the gated community. They are its skin and bones both. 2, since common spaces take many forms like streets, parks, community areas, shopping areas, recreation areas, they facilitate community building. Hence, the quality and design of these spaces may be related to the quality of life there. It was also established through this study that well-designed common spaces lead to a sense of safety through reduction of crime and its fear, and enhanced vehicular and pedestrian efficiency. With respect to each spatial zone, starting from the gated entrance, to roads, streets, pavements, to the common areas around and within the residential blocks and other common areas. Accommodating facilities and amenities like a club, grocery store, saloon, auditorium, community hall, etc. The morphology of common spaces in gated communities has been presented in the next few slides. Especially noteworthy is the need for designing welcoming and multifunctional entrances at the interfaces, be it at the main gate, entrance to the building block, or the dwelling unit itself, because most of this is compromised by the parking needs. Next in line is the wheelchair accessibility, which is once again compromised for the sake of interesting split-level designing. Last but not the least, it is recommended that all common spaces should offer functional diversity and interest for enhanced perceived user satisfaction. Here I can surmise by reaffirming Rapoport, who has stated this for public spaces, but may well apply to common spaces too, that they should be designed as a setting that is part of the system while deciding conceptual framework. Before closing, I would also like to tell that this was an empirical study for an MR thesis done in 3-4 months' time. But I do think that the results are encouraging and suggest that if this study should be refined and replicated in a larger context, it could definitely help us reach concrete conclusions and may even lead to developing a design and audit tool for common spaces in gated communities, which could strengthen the hands of the designers and architects. Thank you.
Thank you, Preeti ma'am. I welcome you again. Could you please switch on your video so we have questions for you? Architect Preeti G. Bhatia, ma'am. Hello. Yes, ma'am. Ma'am, I welcome you again. Am I audible to you?
Yes, you are.
Yes, ma'am. Yeah. Thank you so much for the presentation. We have a question for you. Can you please discuss the role of hardscape in these open and public realms, particularly for the physically for the specially abled people, disabled people?
In the last slide,
ma'am, your voice is not audible. Yeah.
Just a second. Am I audible now?
Yes, better, ma'am.
Okay. So I got out in my last slide also, and it came out in my study also, that the hardscaped areas, which may consist of blocks and the streets and also some commonly accessed areas like the shopping areas or the club, that they do need to be accessible to the physically disabled. In fact, the societies that I came across, that I studied, because they are for the army, they are the Army Welfare Housing Organization societies, and we do come across owners and tenants who who may have suffered some way physical some instances. Because these are all army officers,
right?
So that thing has been taken care in one society, and the other two, I had mentioned, it came out because the two societies that I studied were split level, designed on split level, and 50% access lifts and all. Also, the ramps, etc., are not there, which makes it difficult for can be there on the streets, you know, not in the parks, and also they can be, you know, they are hard to access half of the, and I was a lot of citizens also in the
right.
In these societies, because they are mostly maybe occupied. Retirement. So sure. These people were also, and they were able to bring this point out that they'd be very happy if there could be full lift accessibility for each house and also for all these spaces, the common spaces, right. Which was not there.
Right.
Yeah.
Right, ma'am.
Because and that is why I brought this point out in the last slide,
right.
That for the sake of split level, interesting split level design, as we architects always go out for. The accessibility has been compromised.
Right, right. Because it is not only, but it's also for their parents and, you know,
everybody.
Yeah.
All the people who are mobility challenged.
Right.
It is difficult for them.
Right.
Yeah.
Also, ma'am, since, you know, officers and people from the armed forces always lived in very close to nature, but, you know, after time they shift to these places. So I think the accessibility to the visual greens and to
is
becomes
very
less
important.
Yeah, don't you feel that there is a percentage of terrace gardens and vertical gardens, these kind of housing societies to improve their ability? Because I think this is not the AWHO complexes generally. It's the basic facilities.
You're right. You are so right. But I also found out that, you know, these people mostly they are simple people with simple.
Absolutely.
And that is perhaps the reason we have, you know, I could see all these spaces, the dwelling uniquely designed, and the vertical gardens that you were talking about most probably is not possible. Why? Because vertical gardens will happen on the building blocks, mm-hmm. and building blocks are comprised of dwelling units which belong to different people.
Right.
You know, it is not the ownership like a mall or anything.
Right.
So, keeping that in view, vertical gardens most probably is not such a good idea. And in my paper, I had brought out this fact that the balconies and the, you know, places from where you can look out, the windows and balconies is on the street. You know,
right.
The crime prevention through environmental design principles. This is one of those wherein the balconies and the windows, they promote the... nobody there, it promotes the safety, the feeling of safety, and it reduces the fear of crime.
Right.
So the vertical may not be such a great idea, but yes, the terrace gardens, definitely, yes.
Yeah.
And
the terrace gardens, even gardens, maybe, or a sustainable landscape, because me myself being,
I am from the same fraternity. And,
yes, ma'am. I can understand. That is the reason.
Yes, of course, I do think that sustainability has been bottom line in the design of the societies that I studied, because they were designed in the early at the turn of the century, actually. And right now, gated communities we come across, they are more flamboyant in nature, they are more let's say more showy, more luxurious, but I took up this because it was to address the needs of the middle income or the society to
True.
Which most of the world belongs.
True.
So that was the idea.
Right. Thank you, ma'am. Yeah. Thank you so much.
Thank you. It was inside the
research. Yeah. Thank you so much.
Thank you. Thank you. And thank you very much for giving us all this platform to, you know, speak from. Thank you.
Thank you so much. Moving forward. A primary issue related to conservation is the lack of awareness, I believe. It is generally seen that the general population does not realize the value of the heritage they possess. It is so, but at times, very like that with the Manzil, Hyderabad, where there was a huge protest by the citizens when it pulled it down. Today, we have with us Professor K. Sinha, Associate Professor from Sri Venkateshwar College of Architecture, to highlight on one of the issues of with her paper, and that being pros and cons of political space on a heritage site, Iram Manzil, case of Hyderabad, Telangana state. The paper has been co-authored by Dr. Pramod S. Shinde, Director, Jawaharlal Nehru Institute for Advanced Studies, Hyderabad, India. I now invite Professor K. Sarda to present her paper, please.
Good evening, everyone. I would like to thank the conference team for giving me this opportunity in presenting my research paper for the conference ICRC 2K20, Rediscovering Cities, with the theme Issues and Challenges. I, Sarada Kapila, an architect and urban planner from Hyderabad, like to present some points on the construction of a new secretariat building in the state of Hyderabad. This is my emphasis is the government proposal for this new secretariat building. Initially, the proposal was on Bison Polo Ground, that is, the land belongs to the defense people. They were adamant against allotting this land to the state government. But the state government, after negotiating with the central government, got approval. But later on, it changed its decision and shifted the construction of secretariat building on a heritage site, that is Iram Manzil, located in Kaithabad. I would like to share some points through my presentation. So as you all know, the title which I have chosen is Pros and Cons of Political Decision on Heritage Site, Iram Manzil, Case of Hyderabad, Telangana State. Now the thing is, this heritage Iram Manzil site comes under B2 heritage category in the list of Archaeological Survey of India, which was built by Nawab Safdarjung Mushir ud Daula Fakrul Mulk in the year 1870 on a top of hillock. They're located in Eragadda, that is in Kaithabad, Hyderabad. Now, presently, this palace is with Public Works Department and houses various engineering offices in the state of Telangana, that is in Hyderabad. Now, for the purpose of constructing this secretariat building, new secretariat building, the government has, present Telangana government has come up with a new Telangana Heritage Act, that is 2017, and they have deleted Iram Manzil from the heritage list. And there was a huge protest by the public and some of the opposition parties, political parties. So what the government says, reasons cited by the government are, the Iram Manzil structure is in a dilapidated condition. But the fact is, the structure is being certified for its structural stability by a team of experts comprising of structural engineers and architects appointed by the Indian National Trust for Art and Cultural Heritage, that is INTAC. So this is the status. Then it is the first and finest palaces built by the Nawab Safdar. And this, because of this palace, it has awarded as the best heritage city. Hyderabad is the best heritage city, and this, it has a beautiful location facing Hussain, located on a hillock facing the Hussain Sagar Lake. Now, the research paper, after a comparative study of some of the aspects relating to the historical, architectural, cultural and heritage importance, and also with respect to the location, convenience, traffic conditions, and other bottlenecks and scope for future expansion, comes out with the strategies that the building secretariat on the heritage site is not the correct decision by the government, and the existing secretariat is the correct place for the successfully conducting the government operation administration. Now this secretariat where it is located is of 25 acres land, and this used to cater to the needs of both the combined states of Andhra Pradesh and Telangana governments, and it has been proposed for future 50 to 60 years for a population of 8 to 10 crores. Now presently it has to cater to the needs of the only Telangana government, which is of around 3 crore population. So this is the thing, and now with the present existing situation, it is not advisable, and my objective is to focus on the pros and cons of both the secretariat building sites, that is the existing secretariat and the proposal on the RM Manzil site. Methodology adopted is a qualitative research methodology with primary field visits and personal interviews conducted with the public and various and public and experts from fields of architecture, conservation and urban planning. And after the interview, experts suggest that people and public and experts' opinion is the existing location of the secretariat is perfect with the with respect to all facilities, and actually the in fact the secretariat is being designed as per the norms, perfectly located, and all the buildings are very well oriented to get natural light and air circulation, and it has all the facilities to cater to the smooth functioning of the government. The government decision is detrimental and not reasonable in terms of historical, social, economic and cultural context. Now among the interview people, 90% of the people were against the government decision for the construction of secretariat on the RM Manzil site and expressed that in present scenario there is no point in going up for a new secretariat. 10% of the interviewers suggested that government can retain and renovate the existing blocks of the secretariat. And some of the seniors recommended that if the government is so keen for a new secretariat, it can go with the proposal by selecting a site in suburbs without demolishing the existing secretariat buildings. Now government is has overlooked the fact that under the master plan 2010, certain areas of Hyderabad have been declared as special reservation zones, which incorporates heritage buildings and heritage sites. And the earmarking of RM Manzil as a special reservation zone and the proposal of constructing a new secretariat with a built space of 6 lakh SFT costing over 5000 crores, which is a public taxpayers money, is absolutely not advisable. When the current secretariat site is found to be good enough for the combined states of Andhra Pradesh and Telangana, there is no potential reason for building a new secretariat for the smaller state of Telangana. This RM Manzil is a distinct Indo-Islamic architectural style. It's one of our many heritage sites that reinforce the Indian Muslim identity. And is at risk for demolition at the hands of the state government and needs to be preserved to retain the heritage and culture of the Telangana. Now actually we have missed the UNESCO's World Heritage Tag in July 2019, and it has been backed by the Jaipur city. Historians and heritage activists feel that with its Hyderabad, with its rich legacy of architectural and cultural landmarks, it should be in the UNESCO list of World Heritage Site. The visionary Nawab Fakhrul Mulk, who had several portfolios as Minister of Law, Interior, Police and other offices, was a genius in urban development and was instrumental in modernization of Hyderabad. He built the royal palace in the wilderness on the city outskirts and was a key man in transforming this part of the country into a modern state in India. So instead of neglecting and demolishing historical monuments, the government can take steps for restoration of these priceless monuments and convert them into useful spaces. Following such a modus operandi, the state will get a lot of kudos for the beautiful heritage building, retaining heritage building, and the state will also not to incur a lot of money on building a new secretariat. In this COVID-19 times, when the economy is in doldrums, this money can be usefully spent on much required public health and welfare schemes. Thank you.
Thank you so much, Professor K. Sarda. Can I please request you to turn your camera on? Ma'am, can I request you to please? Yeah. Thank you so much.
Yeah. Good evening, everyone.
Good evening. I welcome you. We have some questions for you. Listing a historic structure and preparing the conservation plan is definitely a very tedious job, but the owner of the property takes no time in pulling it down whenever it's required. But do you feel that this is more because of the lack of documentations, particularly with the local bodies?
Yeah, it's true, particularly with Hyderabad.
So what is the suggestion? Is that we bring more awareness in them, or how do we reinforce this?
Yeah.
That there's more documentation happening.
Documentation and preservation is required.
Ma'am, I request you to... Your voice is not audible, ma'am.
Hello. Yeah, hello. You are able to hear me?
Yes, ma'am. Now it's... Yes.
Yeah, awareness is required in protecting the heritage site.
Okay. And how can this be possible? The awareness...
Hello.
Yes, ma'am. Any recommendation? Ma'am, am I audible to you?
Yeah, I don't know. From the evening, I have disturbance with your side.
Okay. Just one more question. Have there been any awareness programs for the Iram Manzil? How is it that the locals feel so connected with the building? Any awareness programs particularly with the Iram Manzil in Hyderabad?
Yeah, Intact has come up with a lot of opposition.
Okay.
Finally, the government has dropped its plan, and now they are going with the existing secretariat site.
Okay.
But the problem is they want to demolish all the buildings and construct a new building.
Altogether. Okay. So there are awareness programs happening.
They started demolishing the building.
Okay. Okay. But then there are awareness programs happening. All right, ma'am.
Yeah, it is there.
Thank you so much, ma'am.
Thank you for
research paper. Yeah, thank you so much. Thank you. Good evening. Yeah. India was under the British influence for over two centuries, and thus the urban morphology still has many stories to narrate. Next paper is a trajectory of colonial development in the Indian hill stations. We have Professor Kanika Bansal from School of Planning and Architecture, Chitkara University, Punjab, to present her paper, which is Development of Empirical Hill Stations in India During the Colonial Regime. The paper has also been co-authored by Professor Pankaj Chhabra from Department of Architecture, Guru Nanak Dev University, Amritsar, Punjab. I now invite Professor Kanika Bansal to please start the presentation.
Good afternoon, I'm Kanika Bansal, and I will talk on the development of empirical hill stations in India during the colonial regime, which is a topic as a part of my PhD from GNDU Amritsar, The objective of my study is to outline the trajectory of colonial development in the Indian hill stations that stand as ensembles of colonial heritage in India and identify the contemporary threats of urbanization that they are exposed to. Primarily, the structure of my presentation will consist of the genesis of hill stations in India, how they were the seats of political and administrative power and the symbols of a social transition, what was the development pattern that includes the urban morphology, building typologies, and the architectural vocabulary, the contemporary threats of urbanization on these hill stations. The hill stations is a commonly high altitude settlement and is a phenomena mainly associated with the British established by the East India Company for satisfying the needs of the British soldiers and the civil servants. Anthony D. King, the famous architectural historian, says, "Hills were an integral part of the colonial community since it gave the British an advantage of a cooler climatic environment which the white men were accustomed to. Although the exact number of such establishments is unknown, they were around 18 number, which transformed from small hamlets into hill stations and witnessed an increasing influx of Indian and European visitors leading to scaled developments. Now, what were the stages in which these hill stations evolved? The establishment was basically evolved in 19th century in three main stages. The stage one, which is the development as a sanitaria to a huge refuge zone, which is from the early 19th century to late 19th century. The second stage was transforming into a hill station from a refuge area, which is the late 19th century to early 20th century, because of the British officers being stationed there for a good length in a year. Establishment of a town from a hill station was the third stage, which is from the earlier 20th century to the mid 20th century. The hills evolved after 200 years of British in India and established as many as 80 hill stations in altitudes between 4,000 to 8,000 feet. The chronicle of developing hill stations began way back in 1815 after the British defeated the Nepal kingdom in Simla, Almora, and Mussoorie in the northwest. A decade later, Darjeeling was founded in northeast, and the conquest over the Peshwa rulers led to the founding of Mahabaleshwar. Similarly, Assam's conquest led to the establishment of Chirapunji in the south, and journey continued. Gradually, East India Company annexed many strategic boundaries, some to protect the Himalayan border and some to establish military cantonments or sanatorias. Therefore, Anthony King says, without the existence of European military force in India, the modern hill stations would not have been developed. The map alongside details of the four hill stations in India, which were established along the four ruling presidencies of Delhi, Calcutta, Bombay, and Madras, which were their working bases from where the British commanded their administrative and political powers. The selection criteria of the hill stations was first the elevation level, which was preferred between 6,000 to 7,500 feet, the temperature range, which was much lower than the plains and provided heat relief, the relief from disease, which was above the territory of the malarial mosquitoes, which were prevalent in the plains, which provided some sort of a seclusion away from the indigenous people, and of course the natural beauty, which gave the picturesque scenery resembling the European landscape. The classification of hill stations was done on the basis of two types, large stations and small stations. The large stations were the official hill stations, which were the multifunctional stations that served mainly as government headquarters as well as educational, recreational and social centers. These were the major centers of development, for example, Shimla, Uti, Nainital and Darjeeling. The private hill stations like Mathuran, Kodaikanal, Mussoorie fall under this category and were established as an outcome of the social structure and lifestyle of the British. The small stations, the single-purpose stations, were like cantonments or enclaves of railway workers. The minor hill stations were like Subatu, which served as recovery stations for military as well as sanitarium for the American missionaries. The third type of the small stations were the satellite hill stations, which were stationed around the larger stations for improved working of the larger hill stations like Subatu, Sunar, Kasauli, Jutog and Dakshay. They were all stationed around the larger hill station of Shimla. Now, as we all know that they began as small hamlets, but gradually they took significance because of their political and administrative powers. This is the time when many hill stations were converted into summer capitals of British, from where the company officers took command during the summer season. It became the most visited retreat for many British officers until 1864, when it was declared as the summer capital. So Shimla was declared as the summer capital for the entire country, and Nainital, Darjeeling, Shillong, Mahabaleshwar and Uti were provincial capitals for each province. This became the main reason for urban expansion of the hills. Hills became the most wanted seat of functionaries, Indian princes, as they wanted to be closest to the administrative offices, which triggered the development of government infrastructure, schools, and religious institutions, along with the promotion of indigenous crafts and markets. They also were a symbol of social transition, where the Britain-like social structure, like evening strolls, get-togethers, dinner balls, club activities, picnics, theatres, all led to the transition in the system of social, This social structure was unique to the Indian subcontinent, which pulled the Europeans and the Indian elites, like the upper-class Indians, including Maharajas, merchants, and lawyers, to not only enjoy the myriad climate, but also the picturesque beauty of these hill stations. The establishment of a company managed sector based on agriculture gave a lot of economic benefits and, of course, unique identity to some of the hill stations like Darjeeling, which was incepted in 1850, but is the largest tea estate in the world till date. The change in the lifestyle and social structures dictated the urban morphology and the building typology of these Indian hill stations. The urban morphology was primarily dictated by the social practices, steep slope valleys, existing mountain ridges, and so on and so forth. So the military cantonments and Indian bazaars stood at the peripherals of the station. The fact that all Indian bazaars were set apart from the European settlement reflects the discrimination by the British for the indigenous people. There was a main access on the ridge, along the ridge, which was called as the mall, along which the primary functions were placed. And gradually down the ridge, there were different sort of functions. And the elites were close to the ridge and the Indians, which were secluded, were away from the ridge, which is seen not only in Shimla, but as a pattern, it was also seen in the urban morphology of Mussoorie. If you see this black line represents the Mall Road, which was the main axis of Mussoorie, and all the main functions of the town were located around this main axis. And the Indians were primarily stationed off this main axis, which was the main center of attraction for the European visitors. Now, all this also led to a separate architectural vocabulary and a building typology, which was typical to these hill stations. The diversity in function of each hill station dictated the building typology. For example, in the multi-station or the multifunctional hill stations, there were buildings like government buildings, telegraph offices, railway buildings, sanitariums, hospitals. There came up social buildings like library, clubs, golf courses. There were buildings like residential buildings and country houses and the bungalows, which are very, very unique to these hill stations. You have educational institutions. Unfortunately, I'm a product of one of the old schools of Shimla, which is the Auckland House School, the police chowki, the post offices, the religious buildings, especially the Anglican church. Most of us who visited all these hill stations know that churches are the buildings which are placed at the center and the heart of the station. Now, these building typologies were, like I said, churches, the theaters, the town halls, which are a reflection of the social structure and, of course, the changing lifestyle of the Indians and the Europeans. Now, the architectural vocabulary, which was a revival of the European, Tudor, British, Gothic, Swiss, Gothic, Renaissance style, was built. They built Gothic villas with gabled roofs, half-timbered Tudor cottages, and gingerbread-ornamented Swiss chalets. They made buildings in locally available material like timber and stone with mud as their building material for construction of cottages, bungalows, and government. Now, all this contributes to the architectural vocabulary of the hill stations. And if you see on the right, you see the Viceregal Lodge, which completely is a unique example of all the building typology and the unique architectural vocabulary which was followed on in the hill stations of India. And if you see here, this is the Bantany Castle, which is lying in shambles nowadays because of the fire which broke out in the Bantany Castle, I think last year or probably last year, last year. So all this that I just mentioned is undergoing a lot of threat of urbanization, especially because of the population inflation, because population inflation is one of the main problem of the time, specifically in the 21st century, which has seen a sharp increase as of the population. There is an increased demand for residential, educational, recreational, and commercial areas for the indigenous as well as the migrants, which leads to haphazard and uncontrolled development. There is a huge tourist influx. The hill towns have experienced an increased tourism, which also serves to be one of the main sources of economy for the locals. While this has had added to a lot of new development like hotels, guest houses, commercial areas, recreation centers, transport hubs, etc., it poses a threat to the values of the cultural heritage in these hill stations. And therefore, there is a depleting cultural heritage which is being experienced in these hill stations. As you can very well see in these photographs, the existing colonial heritage in the form of bungalows, in the form of institutional buildings, in the form of government buildings are all experiencing a threat of depletion. And if we do not take care of them, they will ultimately decay and they will be lost. We are also seeing uncontrolled and insensitive urban development. If you see this photograph is of Shimla, which is in 1937. And comparably, if you look at 100 years down the line, look at the kind of built which has been there on the topographical, the topographical line of this hill station. So if we look at the transformation that these hill stations are witnessing, it is not only posing a threat on the environment, on the lifestyle, but it is also posing a threat on the existing lines of cultural heritage, which was unique earlier and it stood apart. But in, as you see, 1937, but in 2019, you see it stands amidst a myriad of these building or a concrete jungle it has become. So therefore, the study presents an insight as to how and why hill stations have been socially, politically, and culturally significant in the history of India. They were not only summer retreats, sanitaria, bases to military, homes to retired civil and government servants, but gradually became important seats of governance established by the East India Company in the annexed India. They functioned as summer imperial capitals during the British regime, out of which Shimla became the most important capital. British, in the pursuit of power and rule, not only transformed the social and political structure by bringing European culture, but significantly contributed to the innumerable architecture and urban ensembles that stand tall till date and reflect the rich, glorious past and historical association. These ensembles reflect a unique style of architecture, material and technology, which the British officers in India very eloquently designed and built and contribute to the rich legacy of the colonial era. Departure of the company did not impact the growth of these hill stations, which continues to grow and becomes favorite tourist spots even today. The present age hill stations are witnessing an unprecedented and uncontrolled urban growth impacting the physical environment and act as a major threat to the cultural and social heritage values. Therefore, as a PhD scholar, the study gives me various leads for future research. It orients me to bring out the historical significance and values attached to the vast colonial heritage of these hill stations in India. And of course, as a researcher, it further leads me to find out the methods and strategies to safeguard this cultural heritage amidst rapid urbanization. So these are the references of my presentation and my paper. And I have my due acknowledgements and thanks to the Municipal Corporation, Shimla, Himachal Pradesh, and of course the Himachal State Archives for providing authentic, relevant data regarding the development of hill stations during the colonial period. Thank you.
Thank you so much, Professor Kanika Bansal. I welcome you. Could you please, can I request you to please start your audio and video? Hello. Yes, ma'am.
Hello. Hi, yeah. Ma'am.
Hello, ma'am.
To start my video because it says failed to start the camera.
All right.
Start my video.
Can you hear me, ma'am? Am I audible otherwise?
Am I audible?
Yes, ma'am. Can I take the questions, please, for you?
Go ahead, yeah.
Yeah. There's a question which says the British officers in India had different sets of hygiene as the Indians did. Was this visible in the urban fabric of hill stations?
Of course, yes. This was the primary reason why the hill stations were developed. Because hill station was a unique thing developed by the British itself way back in 1816. Before that, there were small hamlets which were here and there somewhere. But all of a sudden in 1816, when the British wanted to break away from the absolute heat of the plains and they wanted to break away from the indigenous people of India, They just wanted some retreat and a place where they could go and, you know, probably break and come back to work refreshed and rejuvenated.
Right, right. So
that is how these hill stations were developed. And since they were unique to British, and Indians were only a part of people who were serving these British, therefore, you know, hygiene and health was, of course, paramount for them.
Right. But that change is very evident now, right? Like,
yeah,
now
that's what the inquiry basis is, that why they started, how they started, and what they have developed into is what right. is the inquiry basis now.
Right. Okay. One more of you, yeah. Did the building use change when during winters the structure was not functioning as offices? Did you come across any example like this?
Can you go again? Your voice is cracking.
Am I audible, ma'am?
Yeah, you are.
Yeah. Did the building use change when during winters the structures were not functioning as offices? And did you come across any such examples?
I am yet to go in the nitty-gritties of each and every right. structure. Right. However, these buildings have undergone a tremendous change. For example, I mentioned about the Viceregal Lodge.
Right.
The Viceregal Lodge was back in 1875 as the house of the governor or the right. highest, you know, viceroy of India,
yeah,
right?
Yeah.
But gradually over the years, it transformed into the Indian Institute of Advanced Studies, which is what its present function is now. So okay. not only this Viceregal Lodge or the Indian Institute of Advanced Studies, there are n number of buildings which have changed their use, and also not only their use, but also their aesthetic values and their, you know, architectural values as well.
Absolutely.
So that is what the entire inquiry line of this PhD research is all about.
All
so
right.
I'm going to gradually look into it,
okay.
and I will take a note of this question and definitely get back to this.
Right. It's amazing. Thank you so much. Also, I wanted to ask, like, you know, the architectural character of all the hill stations is changing. Probably, you know, these small cafes and all these things is coming. So can we retain the architecture character as well, you know, in some recommendations to the...
is what I am looking at, because when we look at a building or a monument or an ensemble, yeah. when we say, we do not look at it independent of its context.
Right.
And we cannot say that whatever was built way back 200 years ago is static and we cannot touch it or change it. It has to respond to the need of the time and the changes that are contemporary. And of course, people would need it. So if it was lying around a context where there were no built forms originally and they have sprung up over the years, the question here comes in, what should be the character of these built forms? You cannot just come up with a solution and say that nothing should come up or it should stand static and should not be put to use. So that is how the concept of historic urban landscapes come into action, where you are using these existing cultural resources as a, you know, contemporary need.
Right. So I think continuity of architecture character, probably more research would have to be.
Absolutely. Continuity is very important, yet responding to the change and time is also very important.
True.
Yeah.
Thank you. Thank you so much, ma'am. Thank you
very much. And thank you, team MAU and ICRC, for hosting this wonderful event. Thank you very much.
Thank you so much. We'd like to take the next press. Yeah. There are many concerns associated with urbanization, as you see, and the city development. One of these is the supply of water, as water is one of the basic necessities. Highlighting the performance of water supply in cities, the next paper is from Engineer Rhea Ruby, Dr. Chitra K from the National Institute of Technology, Calicut, India. The title of the paper is Water Supply Performance Assessment, a Framework for Evaluating Urban Service Delivery Efficiency. And the paper is being presented by Engineer Rhea Ruby. I invite her to please start the presentation.
Hello, I'm Rhea Ruby. I'm a civil engineer and an urban planner. I'm a faculty member of the Department of Architecture and Planning in IIT Calicut, and I'm presenting here Water Supply Performance Assessment, a Framework for Evaluating Urban Service Delivery Efficiency. So this is just an introduction on what performance is and what performance assessment is. So as far as the urban context is considered, the quality of services received by citizen in return of the tax he or she pays is always questionable. So hence we need or we require a performance measurement framework to assess the efficiency of the services. Like the water supply, the transport, the connectivity, the solid waste management, the power, etc. So this research involves identifying variables for formulating indicators and creating a framework for assessing the service delivery performance and subsequently demonstrating its application to evaluate the efficiency of water supply system in the city of Kochi in Kerala as a pilot. So a framework will be formulated based on variables and indicators which would measure the performance outcome of a service. Here the water supply is being considered and it is demonstrated for the city of Cochin. And this framework considers the provider level aspects as well as the consumer level aspects as well. So I would like to start with the background that we know that cities are continuously facing a challenge to provide its citizens with proper quality services, and the efficiency of the services is also an issue. So there already exist many parameters, many indicators and methodologies which measures the performance, efficiency and quality of these services, like the livability standards, the sustainability index, the water performance index, etc. Despite this, a composite indicator that measures the efficiency of urban service delivery from a provider level as well as a consumer level is still missing. So this would also incorporate competitiveness in the government sector, because government is the prime provider of the services as far as essential services are being considered. So with this background, the study tries to formulate a composite indicator that could be used as a simple tool for evaluating and ranking urban infrastructure and services. The aim of the study is to develop a performance assessment framework for the evaluation of the urban water supply service delivery efficiency. And the objectives are to identify the variables that would provide accurate data on the performance of water supply service delivery within the city and form indicators from the variables. The second objective is to, depending upon the or based on the indicators or the variables we have identified, to develop a general framework for evaluating the performance of service delivery. And finally, to demonstrate this framework in the city of Kochi in Kerala and understand the performance, its performance, and identify the gaps in water supply service delivery. So this is the overall methodology. I am discussing the detailed methodology in the coming slides. The overall methodology includes a thorough literature review to identify the variables as well as to study about existing methodologies. And these identified variables are used to develop a new scoring mechanism. And the new scoring mechanism thereby contributes or thereby leads to the formation of a general framework. And this general framework is employed in the city of Kochi in Kerala to compute the water supply performance delivery score in Kerala, and the results are being discussed. So a thorough literature review was conducted. I'm just highlighting the key takeaways, the important ones. So I would like to highlight that the indicators should not be an account of physical assets, but the quality of the infrastructure. The different dimensions of the infrastructure can be looked at, for example, quantity, quality, reliability, and cost. And this can be indicators. Supplier level and the provider level have to be considered. And for the methodology as well as the variables, literature were referred and all the variables were listed. The existing scenario as well as proposals for the city of Kochi was also studied as a primary study before the research. So let's start with the detailed methodology. The first objective was the selection of indicators. So this is a detailed methodology for that. A literature study was conducted for the background study of existing indicator measuring performance frameworks and other research methodologies. Also some case studies on indicator development was also studied. All the variables relevant to the study was listed down and identified, and also indicators were also identified. The variables were grouped under different indicators, and a three-level screening was done. The first screening was done on the basis of certain criteria like coverage and credibility, relevance, availability of data, validity, representativeness, etc. The second screening was based on checking for benchmarks, whether the benchmarks are already existing or if it can be provided with the benchmark or not. The third screening was based on expert opinion survey, which will be discussed in the coming slides. So the final indicator list has a domain, which is here is water supply. Indicators under the domain, which we have four indicators in total, and the variables under each indicator, which we have total 12 variables. So these are the indicators and variables in my research. So the indicators are supply, reliability, effectiveness, and responsiveness or consumer satisfaction. And the variables are per capita supply of water, household level coverage of direct water supply connection, supply for firefighting under supply, regularity in supply, daily duration of water supply, total pressure head at the delivery point, and frequency of water quality monitoring under reliability, utilization of storage of water, utilization of treatment capacity, and percentage of water connection covered through meters under effectiveness, promptness of repair, review of complaint redress and machinery under responsiveness and consumer satisfaction. And these are the definitions of corresponding variables. Detailed methodology for the second objective, that is construction of framework. So all the identified variables are classified into quantitative variables and qualitative variables. All the qualitative variables are quantified by scale. A 3-point Likert scale was adopted. So after that, the next step is assigning of weights. An expert opinion survey was conducted. We'll be discussing about it. And after assigning of weights, we obtain the final indicator metrics. Benchmarking was done. Computation of standard score is the next step. Then weighing and aggregation and final resultant score. So this together forms a general framework for the computation of performance. Regarding the expert opinion survey, the expert group included urban planners, students, academicians, and research scholars and others. So this sample size was 138 based on random stratified sampling from total population of these above said groups in Kerala. The expert opinion survey involved two parts. In the questionnaire basically involved two parts, which is selection of and ranking. So the survey was an online survey and it was a ranking-based survey. So selection and ranking of indicators within a domain as well as selection and ranking of variables within an indicator was a two parts. So the experts I have already discussed, who are the experts, and the conducted survey generated results. And based on these results, the weights were assigned to the variables based on the method of ranking. And the indicators and the variables with negligible weights were eliminated. Thus, the final indicator list was formed. The benchmark, the sources of the benchmarks are as given, mainly the service level benchmarks provided by MOUD, and the other sources are also listed. The standardization of variables was conducted by using the given formula, that is value of variables in the city of Kochi by benchmark into 100. So the final list of indicators with the weights plus these benchmarks and scaling will give us the final indicator metrics. So this is the weights of different indicators and variables which was as calculated, and the aggregation and generation of the indicator score was using this weighted aggregation method. So we have the equation for indicator score, domain score, as well as a final score. This final score equation is applicable when there are multiple domains. For example, here we have only water supply, but if you are considering multiple domains like waste management or transport or power, final score can be computed using this formula. So now looking at the city of Kochi, the administrative limits of the Cochin Corporation was selected at the site. So now computing the performance score for water supply service in Kochi required certain data, and the data, secondary data, was collected from the government departments. As this research was carried out last year, 2019, the latest data was collected. Primary data was selected from a questionnaire survey, which was mainly for the variables under responsiveness and consumer satisfaction, as well as to cross-check the objective of the data collected from the official sources with the ground reality. The random stratified sampling was followed for primary data collection, which was based on the population density of wards, and the sample size was 366. So this is the result after calculating or after collecting all the data, after processing the data, after applying the data in the developed framework. This is the result. 68.75 is the final score of water supply service delivery performance in the city of Kochi. And some of the observations were made, like the score, the effectiveness has contributed much to the score, as well as the supply for firefighting, the lack of supply for firefighting was one of the factors why the score has been reduced. So in addition to the final score, another important parameter that we could include is a spatial analysis, which was a ward-based analysis. So the ward-based analysis was able to carry out for the primary data collected. So we were able to identify some spatial discrimination as well. For example, these are the spatial analysis done for duration of water supply, redressal of complaints, regularity in supply, and delay in response. Or by overlying these maps, some observations were also able to be discovered, like the older city lacked in generally in the services, and the some areas, especially the people with high income areas where people reside, high income people reside, the consumer redressal, complaint redressal, and the consumer satisfaction was more in those areas. So this is an additional observation as well as analysis for the framework, which is a spatial analysis. So I would like to conclude my presentation saying that this proposed performance assessment is a mechanism that can be employed for quick assessment of water supply service delivery. So similar methodology can be adapted to analyze and evaluate efficiency of different essential services as well, such as power supply, connectivity, transport, health, education, security, recreation, waste management, governance, like etc. Performance score for each domain can be calculated on individual basis, as well as an overall performance score for the city can be calculated using these domain scores. Also, we can adopt these performance framework in different cities. So if we have multiple data points or multiple cities, the framework can be applied, and thus a city performance index can be generated by using this framework. So this framework shall also be helpful in identification of the shortcomings in any urban service delivery mechanism and can thus act as a planning tool for the concerned service provider. So thank you. This is the conclusion and the further scope of my research. So thank you.
Yeah, thank you so much, Engineer Ria Robbie. Welcome you, and could you please, welcome.
Thank you.
Thank you so much. We have a few questions for you. I would like to take one or two for you. How your assessment results help in mitigating the issues of dry cities?
Dry cities. So mainly in my assessment framework, one of the important variable is the supply. So actually we are dealing with the delivery mechanism of the water supply system. So in order to evaluate for dry cities, we have to start from the watershed management as well, like from the source. So we research unfortunately is not part of the mechanism or the processes from the source. I mean the watershed management or the groundwater augmentation, all those parts.
Okay.
Currently there exists the water management index which cover those.
Okay.
In this water management index or the management framework, development ministry of housing and urban affairs, urban water is a one section.
All right.
My framework is actually a part of larger framework, which is city performance assessment framework, which was actually my master thesis. So this is a part of my master thesis, which focuses on the service rather than the dealing with the source or the, for example, source of water. Okay. So I think dry cities.
The problem part, dry city, the source is important. So once that is researched and then.
Okay.
Can you, the second question is, kindly throw some light on the fact that financial status affects the duration of water supply in an area. Is that related? The financial status, different society and,
Financial, yes, because this is an observation made in my research work that when I did a spatial analysis, so are you talking about the financial situation of the people, public or the government?
I think you can just take both, like, you know.
All right. Yeah. So,
but I think particularly since you're talking about supply, so probably for the people, you know, how it supply, it comes down to the people if they have different social
status
and different financial,
All right, so I'll start with the fact that when I did even, first of all, in my context of Kerala, you know, poverty level or the affordability of in Kerala is comparatively higher than states in India. So I think basic affordability for the basic essential services is fair here. And when I did a spatial comparison on a ward-based level comparison, many variables, especially the consumer satisfaction or the complaint redressal, the authorities was higher in the wards where higher income people were residing.
Okay. And it so that was is evident. That is there.
It was very evident. So since I'm showing only water supply in the presentation here. I don't know, it's just two variables which makes much difference.
Okay.
But when you look at the overall framework or the performance of a city, mm-hmm. by looking at all the services, then it was very evident. So the posh areas in Kochi had much complaint from the authority as well as regular supply, because they might tend to complain more or they are more affluent. While the older part of the city, where it is, it has a little bit of slum, not much slum here, but low-income people reside, the supply as well as other factors was affected, so, especially the regular.
So are there any recommendations so that water is for all and, you know, continuous water is there? So are there any recommendations in your paper or you would be working on there?
Yes, I mean, this provides a lot as well as it's evidently shows what is the disparities as well as spatial disparities. So if that index is developed and it is incorporated in the governance, I think it will be a transparent system for the public to understand. So the government would be more accountable as well as a transparent system.
And that's a need that of the hour. Yes. Yeah. Should be for everybody, the basic facilities. Yeah.
Yes, yes.
Thank you so much. Yeah. Thank you so much.
Thank you. Anna. Thanks a lot for this opportunity. Yeah. Thank you.
Thank you so much.
Yeah.
Well, thank you, everybody. That was the last paper for the day. And thank you so much for our session chair, Architect Satish Masur, to kindly sum up the session with his valuable comments and suggestions. So please.
Hello. Am I audible? Hello.
Yes, sir.
Yes, sir. You're audible.
Okay. Is it okay? Okay. As a session chair, I'm delighted. Well done, MMU, and well done your whole team for this wonderful session. I must say it was organized, and the speakers were fantastic. I am honored to present a few notes which I gathered this conference, and I want to say this very shortly, very briefly. I think all the speakers, one thing which is common to them was a fantastic research which they have done, and the way they have data collection systems and the amount of time they put in to gather information was marvelous, much better than what we did in my colleges. The first paper was by, and she speaks about the inclusivity of the woman in public spaces. Very seldom we find such talks, actually, and we always talk about things which are more prevalent and popular. So this was an eye-opener, I must say, and being the first paper, it went off very well. I think all our history is full of get women, and we have had the Zanna areas, we have the female cities, and they always wanted to segregate. Maybe at that time the society was like that. Okay, now Aarti talks about inclusivity of the women centric areas, particularly in public parks, which is very dominant, and she gave that example of Vienna where they picked up the systems, how to include that. Wonderful. At the end of it, it is security, context, and sitting areas, comfort, and all these aspects which make a woman safer. So in short, if I conclude her talk, it was safety of women, which is good. I am reminded of, as she was speaking, I was reminded of Baal as I was walking on the banks of the river, and my own city of Chandigarh and the Bangalore areas. I mean, there is a lot of population, female population, and morning walks. There's a safety when there is the urban patterns are more open and there are more areas which are more welcoming, and at the hindsight, and planned for women, not outrightly saying that this is a woman-centric public space, but yes, you have the feeling for them, you have the attunement for them, empathy for them, and that's how the public spaces regain and rejoice. Well done, Aarti. The next paper was by Pratik. the city talks about aspect of urban ravines and their impact on the health. Done job. And I think what the comparison he showed between the two structures and the depth of the roads impacts the psychological health of the human being. Maybe it may not hamper the physical health, but yes, the physiological health is very important. If you're crossing the road and I see darkness, in the end, I'm hurt. It doesn't inspire me to walk. It hinders me. It stops me. But the moment we open the areas, we have more sunlight, we have more ventilation, we have a destination, it is very inviting. And second aspect about the architectural features, yes, I've been to Europe, you all have been to Europe, and we see those streets, but they are so architecturally rich. You see those lanes, those gullies full of features of architecture, the doors, the windows, the balconies, the glazings, the corbelled stones, so magnificent. It's so beautiful. And as you walk past, so I think architecture, urbanism, all play a vital point on our physiological health. Third was by Varsha K. Tripal. And I think the street selection is important. To Gurgaon, a very difficult subject. And I was happy to see was that extent which he had to do. The problem is that the urban population is growing, and there's no way to check, right? So urbanism is one thing which we are all calculating. We are making indexes. We're doing all that, but that doesn't help until we decide what is the right way. And Varsha said the some streets, like the 30 meter roads, were the roads which were finally adopted as successful, because quotient rate was very successful. Fine. I mean, that's her study. And we have to study the strengths and weaknesses, as she rightly said. But then I think at the end of the day, this brings us to the starting point, Varsha, that if 30 meter road was the index, the best point, why could not it have been adopted in all the areas which became a benchmark later on? Are we doing that in our next planning principle? Cities or neighborhoods or not, that's what we've seen. But nevertheless, wonderful job. Patia and her beautiful daughter, Shara. A challenge to study the European images. Three examples of Chandigarh. Rajiv Vihar and Darshan Vihar, fine. And I think what she talks about is how the builders lure people, entrances and the garden. Friendly, elderly friendly, which they spoke about in the end in some questions. Normally, which they lack, but yes, I think the study was the study facility was important, because this is how we understand what is the requirement of the common man, because these are catering to the middle class, to people like me, to people like you. So, if a builder gives an utopian image, does that function? Was a very fantastic study indeed. Well done, Preeti. Sarda Kapila, she's about the Iram Manzil. I have seen this building, and I think a good point to take that if you really want to use your political power to make new buildings, which all politicians and political builders destroy heritage. I mean, it was the same political will which made Chandigarh. did it not. It was a vision of a visionary, Pandit Nehru. So if you're trying to build a secretariat, you don't need to pull heritage down. And it was a good study saying that in good taste that even if it is not structurally stable, do we need to destroy it? I mean, the Europe is in ruins. And we all go to see ruins, don't we? So if tomorrow this Era Manzil ruin, we still need that. We still want that. So if the politicians or bureaucrats want a building, very rightly stated that they can be at the suburbs. And this is how the development takes place. The Paris, when the President Mitterrand wanted to use his political will to build some new buildings, which all politicians do, they met at the outskirts. He did not destroy the character of Paris. And that's what is that is what's to be done. It's as simple as that. We don't need to intake or encroach upon the areas which are heritage oriented. We have so much of land around. Madam Sarda, it was wonderful. Sixth was by Kanika Bansal, and she spoke about colonial hill stations. The paper was by also co-authored by Pankaj Chhabra. Wonderful documentation, and it took me back to those hills of Shimla and you know all these places which we normally visit. I think they grew. The basic intention was purely selfish. The East India Company wanted to place only the British people, the English people, or all those soldiers who came to recuperate. Fine. I think need became greed, and that's how they grew. Now, she very beautifully showed that picture of 1917 and 2020. My goodness, I could see the whole of the hill, which was, you know, annexed and occupied. And, you know, I couldn't see even a small place left. It is alarming. It is alarming. I mean, the way you are trying to occupy those beautiful hills, and it is dangerous. It is alarming because they are destroying heritage, they are destroying landscape, the ecosystem, but they're also dangerous. And we have witnessed so many accidents, I think, in the last previous years. So at one place, the study was so good that it showed how it emerged, how it culminated, and what was the function. But she also warned us that man be warned, that so that we don't go further and destroy it. Lastly, we talked about what should be the architectural language to preserve. I think it's very simple. What do I go to hill station for? So that I have that image in my mind, it is that image to be built and rebuilt. I mean, if the Getty Theater was built in concrete or something else, it was bad. So it is rebuilt into a form, it is rebuilt into a style which my eyes want to see at that place. So you're using an architectural language of the context, and that's what matters. Well done, and Kanika. So I think you have brought us, you moved us by your research, and I'm sure we are not going to destroy our hill stations in such a way that we don't want to go there. Ria Ruby and other people, one of our colleagues, they are from NIT Calicut. They spoke about water supply efficiency. And the way I'm amazed, I think that's your engineering background, which the way you have tabulated the studies, and we architects could not do it. Amazing study. And one thing which I really admire in your study was that how you could, you know, encapsulate the amount of water required for a certain purpose. And you said that in urban areas where there are richer people staying there, the satisfaction level was more, obviously so, because the systems are better there and the systems are poorer in poorer areas. And I think your assessment came close to a point by saying that equal division of water must be there, and because water is not somebody's property, it's not something, we all are paying for it, and it's our taxpayers' money. So this kind of distribution was very important, and the whole study of the city of Kochi was important. I think it should be given to the public health ministry and departments to be adopted and to study the necessary usage and consumption of water. Well, this was my take on this session. I really, really admire and appreciate all the speakers and congratulate them on their wonderful study. I congratulate MMU, and the team which has structured this whole session wonderfully. Thank you very much, everybody. I, on behalf of MMU, Chairperson Sangeet Sharma, I take leave. Thank you.
Thank you so much, sir. That brings to the end of the day. I congratulate each and every presenter for their efforts and picking up these various detailed issues which were once neglected and sometimes not even pondered upon. But there's so much essential for the development of our future cities. I wish all of them the very best for the future research and other endeavors. And without fail, I want to extend my heartfelt gratitude to you, sir, Architect Sangeet Sharma, sir, for being the session chair and giving your insightful comments to the participants. I'm sure that your suggestions and comments, in fact, they were so positive and they were definitely going to help each participant. I also thank you all for your valuable time and gracing this event with your presence, sir. I would like to thank all the amazing audience also for having a patient ear. So today we come to the end of the second day of 3-day International Conference on Rediscovering Cities 2K20. It's been a successful day and hope to see you all tomorrow for the final day of lecture series, which is in the morning session by Architect Krishna Rao Jayasim and Architect Nizamuddin Ahmed. And we would have the paper presentations in the afternoon session. So please do log in tomorrow. Thank you all for your active participation. Please stay indoors and stay safe and healthy. Thank you so much.
Thank you, everyone. You can leave this meeting by clicking on the bottom icon of Leave Meeting, or you can go to the main session to end this session. Thank you all.
Thank you, Sarah. Yeah, Sarah. Yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah, I can leave, right? Yeah.
Yeah, we can leave. Sejal, you can end the meeting.
Okay, okay. I'll
thank you. Thank you. Thank you, Sejal. And thank you, Sarah. Thank you.
Bye.
Thank you, everyone.